Good evening to my respected directors, faculty members, and my fellow student managers. It is indeed a beautiful evening, all soaked in the delighted flame of mine. This evening, I, Rishabh Singh Bharaj, have the pleasure of introducing you to the star of the show, Mr. Swapnakant Samal, sir. Sir has done his higher education from Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. Sir has more than 18 years of extensive experience in designing and implementing HR policies and people practices across various industries. Currently, as head of HR digitalization in Reliance Industries Ltd, sir extensively works on big data analytics, social hiring, automation, and mobile solution.
Hello.
Sir is certified behavioral interviewer and job evaluator.
Hello.
Sir is also avid professional, blogger, and speaker. In his free time, he loves to mentor young and bright management students on how to build a rewarding career in future. So with a huge round of applause, may I please call upon Mr. Swapnakant sir, so as to get an opportunity for all of us to learn and imbibe from sir. What do you have in store with us?
Good evening. Okay, great. First of all, I would like to thank you, Professor Veluri and Professor Sanjit, for inviting me here to spend time with students. I think, when I got into this room and when I saw the size of the slide as well as the size of the auditorium, it is overwhelming for me. And I'm going to spend 2 hours probably being nervous, 1 hour to speak and 1 hour after the talk. So don't get me wrong that I'm going to speak for 2 hours. I'll not spoil the Saturday evening for you guys. Okay? So, we'll try and make it as dialogue as possible rather than being a monologue. So let's have a deal. You should ask me questions. You should interrupt me and you should ask me questions. And if you don't ask me questions, I'll ask you questions. Is that a good deal to be with me?
Yes,
yeah. Sounds great. Fantastic. So, Sanjit is a friend of mine. I find it also very difficult to call him Professor Sanjit. And but still, if you would ask him to describe me, he would describe me as one of the most mischievous student in the college. And time and again, I have been reprimanded by the professors to behave. And this is called the curse of the professors, that today I am talking on the podium and I am not sitting there. I would have loved to be in a situation where I'm sitting there and making some fun of the students or the teachers. But unfortunately, life is reversed now. And that has been the story of everybody's life. Everybody's life would go through a serious reverse when you move out of this jacketed, white shirt, tie, disciplined institution to a corporate which demands something absolutely different. And you would question that, am I relevant anymore? And let me tell you upfront, none of us, including me, at some point of time, like in your career you are, we were never ready to face what is required in the corporate. Even if you would have worked 3 years. Just yesterday, I kind of spent some time with the management trainee who has joined my team from XLRI, and I was like hoping that students would have gone through serious and series of changes, but things have not moved in that pace in institutions vis-a-vis how it has moved in corporate. So that is where I decided that now that I have spent 2.5 hours with my management trainee giving him a pep talk and giving him a kind of, how the life should be, how the corporate life should be. So that's the best thing to discuss with you all, right? Because it's not a big difference. He's just 2 years senior to all of you. So that way I chose the topic, being relevant. And being relevant is all about how. How in this world, which is changing rapidly, you should stay and you should make yourself relevant so that doesn't matter what changes in technology, what changes in policies, or what changes in processes across organization, you are still the most sought after individual. And each of you, I don't know how many students are sitting here, and I'm sure it would be somewhere around 800 plus students. All of you can stay relevant if you follow certain simple principles in life. And so we will have two sides of this discussion today. One side of the discussion, I'll quickly take you through some of the important things and events and principles in our life. And the second part should be the question answer. Is that okay? Great. So, okay, now I'll start with a very smart question. And one of the smartest questions which I have faced since my kindergarten days, and I still face this question, and many of you would also be have faced this question, and I'm sure one of you can definitely raise his or her hand to tell me the question even before it appears on the screen. So what is the question which you would have faced as a student for the maximum number of times in your life? I want one person to raise hand. So many voices, I cannot. Okay, I see you. You are a magician. What do you want to even see? You are a magician, definitely, yes. Isn't it a very smart question? It's a very smart question, which what do you want to be? I have faced this question in kindergarten. I am sure you would have faced this question in kindergarten. And how many times you have got a consistent answer for this question, all of you? Guess a percentage. Suppose you would have answered three times three different questions, that is 100% inconsistency. And you would have answered the same question three times, same answer, then it is 100% consistency. So where would you see yourself from the spectrum of 100% consistency to 100% inconsistency? Be honest. I only hear the murmurs. I am not hearing any answer. Inconsistent. You are one more magician. Let me see. Any more answers from the top podium? Yes? Consistent or inconsistent? Where would you describe yourself? Inconsistent, right? So every now and then we face this question, what do you want to be? There are some smart HR managers who will come and make you sit and make you nervous, and then they will ask you a question, looking at your eyes, deep into your eyes, saying that what would you want to be? You don't know 5 years, 3 years, 10 years, everything sounds the same. What you would want to be? And please keep this in mind, that you cannot wish away this question ever in your life. Even if you fall asleep, still you cannot wish away this question, because in your dream this question will haunt you, saying that what you want to be. So I have understood this is the stupidest question ever asked to any individual, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why yes? Just because I told you? No? Is there a reason why you say that this is a stupid question? There must be a reason, right? What do you think? What could be the reason? I'm sorry? I can't hear you. If something where your life can go through 100% inconsistency, how can it be a smart question? That's a simple answer. That means what you are saying that you want to be today, or what you would have told yesterday, is no more relevant for you when you have reached a stage where you are actually getting into your work life. You are still a student. You will be getting into work life. Some of you probably would have worked in some other organizations in a different profession. You would get into a different profession, the expectations will change. So this is a question which is absolutely uncalled for. So let me connect it back. Let me ask you a straightforward another question. What do you think which is the most common job in USA? Sorry? Anybody can raise his hand or her hand and can answer this question. Yes? Military. Okay. Any more guesses? Program developer, computer science, engineers. Okay. IT. Waiters. Waiters as in the restaurant, the hospitality industry, you mean to say. Okay. Sorry? pizza delivery. So this is something like what one of your friends said, that waiters are hospitality. Any more? Sorry? Freelancers. That's a very nice answer. Any more guesses? Taxi driver. Who's that person? What's your name? Atul. Anmol. You are the closest. The answer for this is truck drivers. The most common job in the United States of America is truck drivers. And why am I quoting this example today? Have you heard of the driverless car? Yeah? Have you heard of this car which is getting tested in various parts of Seattle now already? Yeah? Who is doing it? Yeah? Who else? Great. So what does that indicate? What does that indicate? So that means this job of most common job in the United States of America, which is about truck driving, will become irrelevant, will disappear. So that's the life which we are in. How many years it will take? Maybe around 10 to 15 years, not more than that. By the time you all graduate and you start becoming as middle management, you will see the driverless cars even flying, even coming to India, and the people who used to drive trucks would be irrelevant. Can you quote an example of Indian, from an Indian perspective, what could be a job which will become irrelevant? Or which has become irrelevant? IT. Well, IT, I would say, it's still relevant. Give them some, you know, weight. Yeah? Courier services. Sorry? STDPCO. Close, STDPCO. Okay, to give you an example, the textile mills in Bombay, what you would have seen today, are not existing anymore. Because it has become irrelevant, because it completely, this entire manufacturing unit has been replaced by automatic manufacturing units. And similarly, there are well-established jobs which will become irrelevant. I will come to those examples a little later. So, bottom line is, today, 65% of the jobs what you guys will be doing to earn your bread and butter are not existing today. Even I don't know, even you don't know. And still, I am expected to talk about how to be relevant, and you are expected to learn from this institution certain skills which will make you ready for future. Is not it a contradiction? What do you think? Do you see a contradiction? When you demand that an institution teaches you certain skills which will keep you relevant in the job industry, will it work if 65% of jobs which you will be using for your bread and butter are not even known to human beings today? Will it be possible? So the answer is very simple. The answer is really no. The answer is no. So what skills do you need to, prepare yourself for the job which is unknown? This is a question which will keep hanging in my mind as well as in your mind till the time we reach to certain conclusions today. So this is the basic fundamental discussion of today. So what skills do you need to prepare yourself for the job which will keep you, which is unknown? And can your institution prepare you for the same? And the answer would be hanging till we conclude our discussion today. So let's take a very interesting situation. How many of you would have seen something like this? All of you, right? The DVD industry has disappeared almost. Or maybe it is available in class 8th or 9th students' books, which is like do-it-yourself exercise. You are not using it. You have a cloud solution today. You can just pull your file or pull your record and put it in the cloud solution, right? And from your mobile, you can push that file to your cloud solution. So the DVD industry, the people who worked in DVD industry did not know this is coming. What happened? How many of you have heard about Airbnb? So the great hotels like Hyatt is wary of the fact that their room rents are being reduced to half of the room rent what they used to earn purely because of Airbnb. And this entire concept of competition came from nowhere. None of us knew that something like this could be imagined, could be designed, could be put into practice, could be implemented within a span of 3 years, which started with some 26 USD, and it is a highly valued company today. Even the best of the bankers, who are supposed to be known as the intellectual capital of this country, other than the IT industry people, they did not know how to work on payment banks. And my friends, I have a lot of friends who are bankers, and today many of the conventional bankers are absolutely not aware of payment banks. They are working in large banks, large public sector banks. So think about the public sector banks where you have put your money. Go and speak to your parents how to treat that money so that it remains safe. Because very soon you will get into a situation where your payment banks would take over the entire banking industry. Is my banking people, if there are banking management students, are they prepared? I'm not sure. So, given this situation, how many of you think that the digital disruption is behind all of this? Do you think the digital disruption is the reason why it's happening? Yes? Or is it happening and that is why there is a digital disruption? Or is it that chicken and egg story? So how many of you can recognize this? Arab Spring. That's right. And how many of you can recognize him? Tayyip Erdogan, the president of Turkey. So there is a very interesting story. So the Arab Spring spoke about killing the digital disruptions. That means the social networking which people were using to gather information and to kind of start creating and planning the entire, the revolution or the rebel was forcibly stopped by the sheikhs of the princes of the Arab so that they don't gather and they don't come to a public view, right? And one of the person who, though he was not from the Middle East, being a country which is neighboring country of Middle East, was severely supportive of killing the freedom of expression through social network was Mr. Erdogan. But what happened next is very important to know. Within next few months, there was a coup in the country, Turkey. And he was hiding for his life. And when he was hiding for his life, to his allies, he sends a WhatsApp message with a WhatsApp image saying that I am fine and I am currently located at this location, please help me. And within few hours, the things changed and he could win that war. If it can be called as a war, it can be called as a coup also, but he won it. The fundamental thing is that the digital disruptions are real and the change in behavior is even more real. So what a person who was ferociously defending not to allow people to use social network was personally using to let people know that he is safe and healthy and fine. That means the behavior which takes almost 265 days to incorporate in a human being so that there would be a kind of, it becomes habit. This individual had changed because of that need within 24 hours. And this is what is going to happen with all of you. And how many of you know him? Anybody who can make a guess? Who is this person? A very renowned person? Yes. The man who wrecks Mullah by playing video games and giving a continuous commentary which is full of expletives that too and makes a lot of money. So tomorrow if you see your younger brother playing video game through all the day, don't bother. He might be making a very good career choice. You never know. So in situation like this, we come back to a very basic fundamental thing in our life, that these digital disruptions are here to stay And if you have to stay relevant, you have to make yourself aware of certain skills which will keep you relevant. So will that be a technical skill? What kind of skills do you think will keep you relevant? Let me ask you, anybody can answer, what kind of skills do you think will keep you relevant? Sorry? Open to changes, okay, great. Any more guesses? Is that a skill, being open to change, is that a skill? You have no choice, right? You have no choice, because if Uber and Ola does not take money from your cash, then what choice you have? You have to pay it through. Upgrading your knowledge every day. Which knowledge? Knowledge is not known. So if you read about something which is already existing in the system, that will give you exactly the amount of knowledge what is ready to you are ready to face today. How will you upgrade your knowledge every day? Okay, so you will also kind of calibrate that with somebody else's experience. So that means you will read something and you will pass it on to somebody else and try to understand. So we can call it networking, right? Okay, I definitely consider that as an important skill. What else? I'm not hearing any diversity voice there. Here there are very few girls who are answering the questions. Am I my questions are so difficult, is it? Keeping up with the latest technology. What is the latest technology you are keeping up with? What is the latest technology you are keeping up with? IoT and machine learning. IoT is not our own technology, right? That technology has to be implemented for us to be a user. Sorry, BI. Business intelligence. Machine learning. So are you writing codes for machine learning? Then how would you update yourself? I would wish to know. BI, business intelligence. How would you know the business intelligence fundamentals? These are all large-scale technologies, what you are talking about. If you have to upgrade yourself, you can only probably read a little more what he said, that upgrading the knowledge. Upgrading the knowledge about that technology.
As of now, we cannot do anything. We have just communication
skills. Okay. So you will have some communication skills which will help you to learn that technology through your friends. Fair enough. I would give that a very good point, because communication skill is again an important skill for staying relevant. What else?
Sir, leadership skills and learning skills.
Yes, leadership skills and learning skills, they are very nice sounding words. What do they mean?
To be able to work in a team and give the right, so to have the right motives.
Yeah. So working in a team, you have been working in a team, I'm sure. Like, working in a team was taught when I was a student.
Yes, sir. So we are having a lot of team activities here and we learn right. A lot. So how to manage the team, okay. Listen to everyone's opinion and then finding out
Fantastic.
The best from the rest.
So working in a team, being in a team, being involved in team responsibilities is what you are talking about.
Yes.
Fair enough. So when the world is moving from analog to digital, the concept of skills are also going through a very significant change. So every individual can be given something called a pyramid of skill. So this is something important for you to know. Why am I talking about this? This is not theory. This is something which is a very practical approach to the skills. The skills are basically like a pyramid. That means the pyramid will have a structure where there would be a base, then there is a center portion of the pyramid, and then there is a top portion of the pyramid. The top cone portion of the pyramid is called your niche skills. Skills that you are not aware of today, or very few people are aware of today. To give you an example, people who are writing coding language for drones would be the niche skill holder, right? Because there are only 200 coders in this entire country who know how to write programming language for drones. There would be a lot of people who would have leadership skills, team building skills, skills pertaining to effective communication, critical thinking, how to think, what to think. These are the kind of skills which are marketable skills. that will help you to stay relevant. If you start running behind how to pick up a programming language for drones, you may not be successful, but you would have super success, which is in a specific area. But the marketable skills are the skills which we just spoke about. And then the basis of the skills are skills which are commoditized skills. That means you have to have something which is as basic as communication. So let's see how our institutions and how our customers looking at it. I'm not sure if you're able to read this. Are you able to read this? Okay. So what is changing? What is changing? Why are we changing? I asked a question some couple of minutes back that what is digital disruption? And is it digital disruption which is leading to this kind of innovation, or is it innovation which is leading to digital disruption? Who is leading to whom? Frankly speaking, it is the innovation in customers' mind, because customers want something which is different. Every time the customer is buying something, actually there is a deep wish to do or to get something different. That is pushing the entire concept of digital disruption. If you see, the first point is customer. They want a two-way communication. Even your fundamental, basic, conventional products like shampoo bottles have started putting one email ID where you can write the product deficiencies or the product issues. Right? You have seen that change, right? Was it existing some 10, 15 years back? And they expect the answer from that particular mail ID. So that is a perfect example of where a customer is looking for two-way communication. Customers are looking for something which is in a way, reputation is being discussed. It's not about discussing how I can change the product. It is an experience of the reputation of that product is being discussed. That why did it happen with me? Why could you not have served me better? Why did I have to move the seats even if I had booked a specific seat in that particular flight? So this is the kind of questions which are getting generated. And with that question comes competition, because competition is reading into the kind of emails which you are generating. No data is private data. Glassdoor data is not private data. Data in Facebook is not private data. Data in your various payments and various apps which you are downloading are not private data. All in every data you have signed a condition of around 1,946 words in any legal kind of contract where you have signed that you are ready to share your data for commercial development. That means it's not private data. So in that, competition is getting to know about the data, and it says competition can come from anywhere because they are knowing where the pain points are. Airbnb knew that people are not happy with the movement of the way the rooms are changed last minute, the way the rooms are not given to people even if they are in dire need of a room. That is how they came out with a solution, business solution. Data, this data which I just spoke about, the not so private data, is becoming the reasons to exist. There could be people who would be selling their own data and will start making money. Think of that. It is possible. People would start making money out of selling their own data, selling the data at the right time so that the institutions, like the medical institutions, can start doing research. You know, there is an example that today, it took 12 years to understand, the doctors took 12 years to understand that peptic ulcer, or the ulcer of your stomach lining, is primarily because of a bacteria called Helicobacter pylori. The reason behind that was that data was suppressed till people started buying medicines online. And when they started buying medicines online, there was a clear case which was established that major people who are suffering from peptic ulcer are being advised by the doctors to eat this specific medicine. And that is how the science world revolted against the data privacy. And this is where we stand today. Because this is giving you that advantage. It's an advantage which has come to you now. Innovation, prototypes are cheap, rapid innovation matters. It takes around 21 days to come out with a new update. If I ask this question very often, if you would have been an app, how many days or how many times in a week or a day or a year you will upgrade yourself? This is what has life become. because the rapid innovation is not huge innovation. The change of concept, please note, the concept is changing very fast. That means you need only small innovation, which is called continuous improvement. This will be important to note, because when you get into organization, you will get into projects which will put you into continuous improvement. There is a product which is nicely kept here, working fine, absolutely no issues, not a single log which you will see which has created problem. But your responsibility will be to innovate a small innovation in that. And you will be getting exactly 120 days to do that. This is how organizations are changing. And if you say that abhi to sab kuch thik thak chal raha hai, then you are going to lose out your rating. Because you have not been sensible to go to people who would be using that product to understand what is the pain point. And that is where the entire concept of innovation, because the product prototype is all over. What is not working, you have to go to human beings. So those who are getting scared about the fact that artificial intelligence will take away the jobs of human beings are absolutely misplaced. You are only going to use your brain to sharpen it. If you have given birth to this concept of artificial intelligence and robotics, I'm not sure why people are even discussing that they are going to take away our jobs. Yes, they will reduce the menial jobs, but they will ask you to be more refined in your approach, in your skills, in your emotions, so that you will understand people better. Value. And everywhere, whenever you are doing that entire proposition of a new disruption, if there is no value, there is no meaning. Absolutely no meaning. There have been so many apps you have. Today, how many apps would you download? You tell me. Very few. Because there are very few apps which are giving you something which is a value add. But there would be people who would continuously innovate, because they can't sit silently unless they come out with something which is innovative. So you will be the buyer. You will choose what to buy and what not to buy. So what are the four skills, if I have to look at, which will keep you relevant? These are the four skills. But let's not discuss the skills right now. Let me take you through a little bit of my personal journey, and then we will focus on this slide. So I come from a very interesting background. I have no formal education for the things what I am doing today. And as one of my friends from the top corner said, that we are management graduates, so how can we use technology? And that's the same question and same answer which I used to repeat myself to in my 20 years of career. I had no different answer, let me tell you. At least he is saying that at this point of his career, when he has not even seen the organization, or probably he would have worked in some other organization. But for me, after 15 years of my service, when I got into something which is pertaining to technology, I was confounded with the same thing, that I am a person who's from the management science, and how would I innovate? How would I talk about technology? And with that, let me take you back to my basic qualification, which is all about cropping. I know how to raise a poultry farm, so I know a lot more about chicks. Okay? I have spent a lot of time in finding out which seed is going to give the right kind of plant and which seed is not the right kind of seed. How many mounts of fertilizer you have to apply to a specific tree to see the kind of growth we wish to. So I did my graduation in agricultural science. And with that graduation, I don't know my career ended or my career started. I'm still trying to find an answer to that. But with that, I had only one ambition, that I have to be in a place which is comfortable. When the question was asked to me, what do you want to be? I never had an answer. I said that I have to move out of the place where I am growing up. I have to get into the four big metros. And for me at that time, Kolkata was also a metro. And now I have realized it's probably not. No offense. It's just a thought for my own self. So I thought that, okay, there are only four metros. I have to get into metro. So my entire objective in my career was to get into a place which is comfortable. Could that be a reason why people look at success from the perspective of materialistic gain? Could that be a reason? So let me ask you this question. What is the definition of success for you? Anybody can answer. Yeah.
Sir, success is achieving what we want and being happy with what we achieve.
Okay. So being happy what you have achieved, that is success. But that is somebody else also answered that, but that achievement goes very faint and very flat when you see somebody else's success.
It's achieving what we want and being happy with what we achieve.
So that what Tendulkar achieved is very great, but somebody is ready to break those records.
Success for him was winning the World Cup.
How
and he's happy with winning the World Cup.
So no, he was happy with winning the World Cup, but was that the success?
For him it was. For it's defined by personal choices.
Right.
So if I'm happy with earning 20,000, then I'm happy. That's success for me. I don't have to achieve, don't have to earn 1 lakh to be successful.
So think in a little different way. When Yuvraj Singh was also part of that team,
yes,
achieved that success, next day he was diagnosed with?
Cancer.
So is that success?
So, but
is that happiness? That,
yeah, but he overcame that. That was success for him.
So success is shifting goalposts.
Yeah, it's
so we are all kind of really kind of one commonality which we are seeing is success is shifting goalposts.
What you want varies from person to person.
Great.
So achieving what we want is success.
Great. So basically what you have right now said that success is something which will shift, success is something which will continue to move on, and success is something which is different. That means when you start seeing it from the futuristic perspective, success is something which is elusive, and when you see the things from the perspective that what has happened in your past, then success is definitely defined. So for me also, I started my career in agricultural science as a student, and subsequently I got into some sort of further degree and I hated it so much, so I didn't know what to do. So in that period of time, for me, success was completion of the 4-year course so that I can start thinking of doing something else. But there was nothing opportunity available. So because no opportunity available, then I started getting into something which is called post-graduation. A post-graduation is something which is basically a kind of thing which pulls down your rating in a corporate sector unless it is in management. I didn't know about it. So when I get into post-graduation, I realized that this is not valued. So success becomes elusive once again. And then by the stroke of luck, and of course hard work as well, then I get a chance to get into IIM Ahmedabad, and I sit next to a person who says on the first day that this is a place where I cannot sustain myself. Think what would have gone through me. The person with whom you are going to work for next 4 years, there are fixed places in IIM Ahmedabad. You cannot change your seats. Your names are printed and there are these research associates who keep taking note of everything, what you make, what you speak in this campus. So the person who sits next to me has decided to move on for civil service. The person who sits the other side of mine is struggling to even get 30% mark. So in a situation like this, I am running with a team of 4-5 members, and one of them has already left, so 4 members who have to do various projects, and the projects are given late in the night around 7:30, 7:45, and is expected to be turned around early in the morning, that is around 11 o'clock maximum. And if it is 11:01, your A becomes A minus. And every 1 minute it becomes minus further. So in a situation like this, the success which was celebrated by my parents and few of friends, I realized the success is still elusive. Because I have got into a situation where I don't know if I can successfully come out of the place, and if I fail to come out of the place successfully, it is a further embarrassment. Forget about the celebration. I would not be in a position to even show my face to a lot of my friends, right? And when somehow time is the best healer and time helps us to pass through that difficult period of life, you come up to a situation where there are corporates who are not landing up for any jobs, even in the best of the institutions. You know why? Because those were the years where there was a fear that 2000 will crash the corporate sectors, 1999. 2000 is going to be the watershed year of technology, and my first tryst with technology happened at that point of time. Sometimes opportunities knock you at the time when you are going through a very difficult phase in your corporate career. So had it not been 2000, my exposure to technology would have remained limited to the tillers, to the tractors, and to the machines like water pumps. But I moved to a technology which is more digital. First time I heard world talking about technology, and I started showing a little bit of interest that can I start working. But the projects did not come. The projects did not come to us. Even if we are in a company which is called, I was working in a company called iFlex Solutions. iFlex Solutions, which is known for its banking solution, which got sold to Oracle Financial Services, the responsibilities to work in such projects never came to us. So success became elusive once again. The entire dream house, which was built on the concept of 2000, swiftly got resolved by technologists, and nobody asked anything about the management professionals, and we were in soup again, that what is the value add which we will do. So the struggling of the career never ends, even if the opportunity knocks. And when you start considering that as an opportunity and start working, sometimes you find yourself you are not suitable because you have not learned certain basic skills in your life. And that brings you back to that pyramid, that what is your marketable surplus? The word which you would have seen in economics very often, that what is your marketable surplus? Leadership skills, communication skills, niche skills, technology, ability to think on feet, critical thinking. What is that something which is very important and dear to your own self? I urge all of you, every day, take 10 minutes to think, what is one skill which you have which will make you stand out? And when you make yourself stand out based on that skill, you become the player, you become the king of that skill. And let me facilitate by saying that you don't need to spend your time in Google search to find out what skills you need. There are four basic skills after years of research which have been found out that come what may. There are four skills which will decide how you will succeed in this world. And there the success definition is that when you have achieved something which has been your primary goal. And with that, let me tell you, critical thinking is one of the most important skills. My friend there said that I am a management graduate. How can I help technology? Would you be able to help now with critical thinking? Will you be able to know what is critical thinking? Do you know what is called critical thinking? It's a very simple thing. It's only a lovely word, but it's a very simple thing. Critical thinking. Yeah. What is critical thinking?
Critical thinking is something is, normally people are thinking, so apart from normal, you just think something different.
Well, critical thinking is something different, right? But critical thinking is about how to give a solution. It's about solution to certain issues which you are facing currently, or which your friends are facing currently, or which the entire nation is facing currently. Each of you have the ability to think something which the entire nation is facing currently, right? So critical thinking is not about what to think. So it is not a different thinking. It is about a solution thinking. Yesterday, when I was in my office and we were discussing this digitization piece, a very simple problem which I, as well as many others, have been facing. We have a 500 acres campus. Humongous. Where you start, where you end, where you get lost, you don't know. The building numbers are even more complicated. Just that they have not put a square root on that number. This complexity of the building numbers they have generated. In that, if a person comes in for an interview, after the person enters the campus, would never be able to find which particular location he has or she has to get into. And then we sat together to come out with a solution, saying that let's create a platform. Have you heard of something called platform? Have you heard? Right? Platform. So platform is one platter. Like you go to the restaurant and you order various things on the platter, and lot of friends enjoy one platter and you end up paying less. It's exactly the same concept, that platform is one solution where many people put their thoughts on a platter and give a solution which is more cost efficient. So this entire concept of people getting into the right location involved HR, which has to pass on the information that the candidate has to be interviewed. It also involved the security which has to create the gate pass. It also involved the people who would receive that individual so that sits in the battery car and comes to the place where the interview will be done. It also involved the people, which is an extended arm of recruitment, which will give him the specific basic form to fill in, get ready for the interview in another 15 minutes. So four people, when they come together with the technologist, with the digital solution provider, with the mobile app solution provider, and start focusing on one problem, that becomes critical thinking. How to give a solution? Critical thinking is all about how. How to give a solution to that specific individual who will be walking in for the interview is your critical thinking. And this critical thinking leads to a solution. And all of them are management graduates. Few of them were technologists. Put together, the HR of the organization is rapidly seeing a change that gone are those days when assistant manager, manager, VP, AVP, director, these kind of designations lured people. But they're looking at situation where such cross-functional teams can be working together to come out with a solution. So the message for you, from today onwards, every day, 10 minutes, any one of the skill you pick up, read books around that. Try to solve issues around that. Try to resolve your things around that so that you get that critical thinking. Because not many people would be design thinking. So what is design thinking now? If I have spoken so much about the critical thinking, which is how, then what is design thinking? Planning. So what is planning? If planning is design thinking, then what is planning?
Sir.
No, you cannot be answering all the questions. Your okay. Quota is over.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Carry on. I'm just joking. Just kidding. No. Carry on. I'm just kidding. Yes. Tell me.
Audible. Okay. So basically, the design thinking is kind of a, you can just create a blueprint of whatever the thing you are going to do. Suppose I am designing a software which is going to work. So I first start with my team, create a blueprint, and after that I start with the coordination of the team and I start working on that. So okay, that is called as design.
Right, that's a very complex definition of design. Design thinking is basically nothing but giving an experience. Giving an experience to that individual who is going to use your service. Today you are not talking about the service, you are giving experience. If you are going to a particular organization, you get an experience. If you are running Standard Chartered Marathon, you are getting an experience. You are getting an experience of how Standard Chartered has branded it, how Standard Chartered has years after years been successfully managing it, how their executives have put their blood and soul to that entire event to come out with something where they get no revenue or probably the revenue is completely sent to the charity. That is an experience. When you get into a Vistara and you move from one location to another location, the way your food is served, the way your seats are designed, the ergonomics of that particular chair, everything is an experience. So from the platform thinking has come the platform service. And the platform service is nothing but design thinking. And if you are good at that, if you have that innovativeness in your own within self to create something which is futuristic, get yourself sharpened on that skill called creative thinking design. And no amount of robotics and artificial intelligence after this will ever bother you. And if you are good at communication, your communication is not about standing on a stage and talking. And very funny that very large institutions of super repute still think that communication is written analysis and communication, where they ask you to define a problem statement, then the 7 points around that, and then prepare a 5-page essay around that, and then submit by X time, and get a grade out of that. That's also not communication. What are you communicating these days? You are expressing your own self within few words in a tweet. How many characters? 140 characters. How many of you can express a political situation in 140 characters? Very few. How many of you can write down the critical problem of the organization in 140 characters? Very few. Right? So are your communication skills great? May not be. How many of you are in a situation to write a negotiated offer or a negotiated contract without any help from anybody? Any one of you has got that kind of experience?
Sorry, I'm sweating.
Thank you. So those are the things which institution is not bound to teach you, my friends. Institution is not meant for that. Institution is meant for imparting the general communication skills. Don't blame the institution saying that they did not teach me, my professor did not teach me, my boss did not teach me. No, nobody is going to teach you. You have to develop that skill. Nobody has taught Shehwag how to write those wonderful 140-word tweets. He has self-learned it, right? Nobody has explained PewDiePie to give those commentary with those expletives. He has picked up himself. And those are the things which is defined as communication these days. Communication is about how would you express list of tasks to somebody who is 15 years senior to you, because you have been entrusted as the project lead for one continuous improvement project. Live example is with me. My person who has learned entire HR module from world's best institution in India, which is called XLRI, is not able to go and communicate to a senior person that how to do these five tasks within these dates. Does he not belong to that institution which is Mecca of human resources? Right? So entire concept of communication has to be revisited by each of you. Let you study, let you learn what your institution is teaching you, but ultimately spend your 10 minutes per day in reading something which is about effective communication. A friend of mine in this group told me that if he has knowledge, he will take that knowledge to somebody who is experienced, share the experience with him, and learn from him. That is networking. Learn how to make valuable networks with people so that you will be chosen as a mentor. Remember one single line which has been adage for years, that when the student is ready, the teacher appears. Change it, flip it a bit. When you are ready, the mentor appears. And the mentor-mentee relationship is something which will be more long-lasting than a professor and student relationship. And this mentor-mentee relationship is the fundamental of learning. And remember, the entire concept of learning has gone through several changes. Today, how many of you have a profile in LinkedIn? How many of you refresh it? How many of you go and create connection every seventh day? The answer dropping down substantially. How many of you have connected your LinkedIn profile to lynda.com? Ultimately, one hand, two hands, three hands. So that means even if you are millennial, you are not doing something which is basic for your learning. You're learning beyond your institution. Pick up your mobile. Your mobile device is the best device. It's called smart, not because you can order half a kilo atta in half an hour. Right? What is not allowed? Mobile not in classrooms. Beyond your life, there is mobile, right? Can't.
Whole campus.
Beyond your campus. No, you're not required in your academy. Beyond your campus, there is no life for you, is it? There is no mobile beyond your life? I mean beyond your campus life.
Yes, sir.
Beyond your campus life, exactly 15 minutes you need to go through one module of lynda.com that is designed to help people like each of you, like me, who does not have much time. On my way home, I pick up that lynda.com. You can save everything offline and read. And it is created in such a manner that it is highly, highly effective. You can certify yourself on 10 things before you complete your management. If you have not tried, you will get all the excuses. No, I'm sounding a bit like a professor now, I think. Is it? No, really, really speaking, from a friendly advice, I must say that lynda.com is something, if you have created your LinkedIn, that means you have a mobile profile. If I have a mobile profile, that means you would definitely be connected to lynda.com, which is at your leisure, you can study something from lynda.com, lynda.com, right? We have just negotiated a deal in our own organization to make every employee go through lynda.com. And remember, in refineries where oil and gas is getting produced, people are not using mobile for sometimes 11 hours. Okay? So it probably you are in similar situation, but there is life beyond that. And this entire concept of networking collaboration is now connected to learning. Why I was talking about that is the profile which you created in LinkedIn through lynda.com, it will get connected to people who are learning the same thing. So you know exactly who are your co-learners and everything is transparent. If you are studying something about effective communication, you would see there are 10 other people in your organization, in your institution who are learning effective communication. Make a club and use that time to discuss effective communication. And these are the ways which is beyond institution to make yourself smart for the 65% of the jobs which you do not know that exists or that are going to get invented for you. So in my own career, when I started doing very core HRBP work, that is HR business partner work. Iska file idhar se leke udhar do, wo file mein ye entry karao, compensation letter chapo. These are all mundane, boring work. I never enjoyed it. Then I got into an organization which was more about all money. How much money you pay as a bonus. Everybody will come and discuss only one thing. I had put in a lot of effort, soul, blood, whatever, all the words they will use. But I haven't got my bonus, which is reflective of my career. And then times changed. And now I am in a situation where I go through a very structured happiness in my life. That is, I look into the pain points of various users. Of course, I limit myself to human resources, but my uses will be unlimited. I look into the pain points. Then I sit together with professionals across industry and across technology. And then I sit with them to find a solution, simple, smart, fast solution, because innovation is very rapid, and then immediately come out with a small innovation. GetPass is a small innovation. Giving somebody the news that the person might be shortlisted. So if you have any plans to go out in the month of May or June, let us know, is an innovation. This is a small innovation which goes a long way to create the right kind of linkage with the organization, with the employee, with the employer, between employers and between employees. So how many of you can, probably this image is not good. You know what is this? This is a 14th century classroom in Bologna. 14th century classroom 200 years back. And this is a classroom of today. 200 years later, have we changed? No. People are still sleeping. There is one individual, if you see, is sleeping. And there are two individuals here who are already sleeping. This is the individual who's sleeping. Okay? Shall I put this one? No. So, classrooms have not changed. Communication also has not changed. What is required is not being taught. What is required is only have to be self-learned. And networking is still within that same sphere of globe. The globe has not expanded. The globe is exactly the same. So what does it mean? It means that the classrooms are no more effective. The classrooms are no more effective, and you have to think of a situation where you have to learn beyond classroom, that is lynda.com. The communications have been stuck at a certain stage, and you have to learn communication which is more Twitter friendly, and you have to start networking because global expansion is still the same. With that, I moved to a situation where I could sense that if I start working on this kind of skills, then I will be in a position to be in various organizations irrespective of the artificial intelligence, what we are talking of, or the threat which we are talking of. So, simple thing, if you have remembered those four skills, there is a way to exhibit those skills, and that is through your energy. I am very disappointed, at the same I am very happy that there are four or five people who are jumping to give a lot of answers. I am disappointed that there are few people who are not even stretching their legs where they are sitting. You have the energy, you have the youth power, you have the energy. If you listen to Satya Nadella, Satya Nadella talks about energy of the youth and how it is going to affect 365 days of his year, of his institution, of his mammoth organization which he runs. Show that energy, and that energy should be basic energy to create something for others, not for yourself. The energy, if you want to know about vaccination, the vaccination which is so difficult for people in sub-Saharan Africa, you know what? The millions of dollars of vaccines were put into a small, simple refrigerator which used to get spoiled by the time it reaches Africa from Europe. An individual who was not even educated, a garage mechanic who had worked a lot of years in AC industry, created a kind of concept that this entire thing can be kept with slightest amount of refrigeration for 6 months. And the sub-Saharan African desert people have started getting the basic need of vaccine. He did not think how to make money. He had an idea, and he could not communicate that idea, so he came and approached a friend of him who carried it over to GE, and GE produced something which carries the vaccine. This is the power of idea. This is the power of energy, because this is an energy which is getting spent to create something for others. Think about the millions of problems which you have in this country. A quest to learn. Every day, 10 minutes, you have to sharpen your skills. You may decide to do it, you may not decide to do it, you may decide to do it later, you may decide to do it never. But ultimately, this will remain etched in your memory. That quest to learn is the basis for being smart and passion to do. If you are passionate to do toilet cleaning, 1.5 lakhs is nothing. Somewhere from that corner, a friend of mine said, yes. And if you are passionate to do something else in your life, then I am sure you will do what interests you. Today, what interests me is to understand the pain point of a user. What difficulty my candidate is facing. And I work on a project called Candidate Experience Survey. And from Candidate Experience Survey, I come out with 7 innovations. And those 7 innovations are looked inside the organization and how to better it. So if you have a passion to do something different in your life, does not matter which stream are you from, which technology are you from, which management institution are you from, whether you are from the top premier school or whether you are from the tier 2 school or tier 3 school, you would get an opportunity to work in startups who will help you to take this entire concept further. In fact, in Reliance Industries Ltd, where I work, we run an incubation called Gen Next, which is nothing but capturing people to give their ideas. And as Mr. Mukesh Ambani keeps on saying in every meeting which we have with him till date, he says that you never know where your competition is coming from. I am not scared of the SRs of this organization or Rosenthal. They are not the oil and gas sector which is going to challenge me. What is going to challenge me is somebody who is sitting in a garage and producing something which you are not even aware of. They are the ones who are going to challenge you. So don't think that you are very well placed, and at the same time, don't think that you do not have the skill. You are not a management trainee or you are a management graduate. You are an individual with an idea. If you can communicate, if you can think, you will be successful. At the end of this discussion, I want to leave all of you with one pet line which I always think of. Live as last day of life, but learn as life is going to be forever. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your wisdom with us.
Thank you.
Now, the house is open for questions.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, my name is Madhur.
Madhur.
Sir, my question is, how do you identify the coming trends in your profession and what's your definition of success with example?
Okay. Now, you ask the second question. It's a difficult one. Okay. I'll definitely try to give an answer. I will try to see if I can make up to the student's level. Okay. Trends. That's a very interesting thing. The trends are there everywhere. It is written everywhere. You have to start reading a lot. A lot of time you have to start reading which is not from your subject. The trend about letting people know about the status of interview has not come to me from HR industry. Nobody in HR sector will ever let you know how did your interview go. They are very scared of that. They will never let you know. And how did it come to me is, because I keep buying stuff from different Flipkarts and Amazon, and I see that I always keep looking at tracking the order. Same thing in the Swiggies also. So if we can expect a product which is simple, some roti dal kahin se mangaya hoge, if we can start tracking that order, then how can I not track something which is about my own career? And this is how you create trend or you learn trend. For trend, once again, it is not limited to your subject. It is limited to what is required by the user and how to provide a solution to that, right? So if you have a mobile solution today, which will show that you applied on this date, your resume has moved to shortlisting, you have been shortlisted, you got interviewed, you are going to get interviewed for the second time. After second time of interview, your negotiation, your salary letters have to be supplied to the respective organization. Will you not be happy about it? He will not call up the recruiter and waste his time. Yes or no? So this trend has come from something which is completely unrelated. To answer your second question, when this entire thing will be implemented, and that day when I will see, people will say that this is a great feedback, I'll be successful. I'll be successful for that point in time. Right? And then I will start putting my nose inside further, saying that what else can be done, that is called continuous improvement. Yes.
Next. Hello, sir. Sir, good evening.
Good
sir,
evening. What's your name?
Sir, my name is Shubham.
Shubham, okay.
Yes. Sir, Shubham Nayak.
Okay, Shubham.
Sir, robotics is increasing day by day. Most of the automotive industries are getting completely automotive. Volvo has already experimented this. Sir, will this increase the employment opportunities or will it decrease? Because this is already happening in small-scale industries. Most okay. of the laborers are being thrown out. Sir, we can take many examples. For example, earlier we used to call 4 to 5 laborers for baking a wall. Now, if you used to call, a single labor comes with a big driller and he... This is time-consuming, but at the same time, this is decreasing the opportunities. So will it pose a threat in the future? Because the same time, population is increasing as well as things are getting automated.
My view to that is contrary. I am the first person and I have always taken the view that opportunities will never change. Opportunities have only increased. When I was a kid, I did not know the word bioinformatics. Today, my sister is studying bioinformatics. Many of us probably would not have heard something called Instagram. But you are born to the age when it is Instagram. People channelize their thought processes and skills to start with something different and better. The human being which was gathering food moved to agriculture. The human being which was in agriculture moved to construction. The human being which was in construction moved to manufacturing. And the human being who was in manufacturing moved to IT. And from IT, they are now moving to artificial intelligence. So human being will move into something which is better. What is that? We don't have an answer. Probably it is something which is super artificial intelligence to make the robots even better. Who will put that intelligence into their mind through codes, right? Who will write those codes? IT professionals, right? Who will create the design, the slick design of a robot? Who will create it? Human mind will create it. Who will teach the doctor to use robotics to do the operation inside your body? Another doctor will teach it, right? So to teach that doctor, there's somebody else who will get trained. So where is it? Only your skills are getting channelized somewhere else. But your skill pyramid is changing because it is disruptive skill pyramid. But what is not changing is opportunity. Opportunity is only growing.
Good evening all. I feel honored and privileged to get an opportunity to propose a vote of thanks. On behalf of Sri Balaji Society, I express my profound gratitude to our guest, Mr. Swapnakant Samal sir, for sparing his valuable time to guide us for a successful career. We are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence and immensely benefited by your inspiring address, especially importance of being relevant in the world of rapid change, making us realize about the job which is unknown and questioning whether we are prepared for it or not. Critical skills related to creative thinking design and how to create that design in effective and efficient manner. I would also like to thank our beloved Bala sir for his guidance and providing us such a stimulating and learning environment. Thank you.